dumped their neurotransmitter into the synaptic cleft. And on the other side of the synaptic cleft, of course, there is a dendrite of another cell. It's quite nasty with these. Fix that. And there are receptors here. We'll talk about that in a minute. Vesicles have fused and released neurotransmitter, and the neurotransmitter has to be taken back up into the presynaptic terminal and then repackaged into vesicles. And I've tried to cartoon the synapse as having some vesicles that are docked and some vesicles that are not yet docked. And I've decorated this with some things, and I'm going to ask you to narrate the story. What is this? The sodium potassium ATPase. ATP is hydrolyzed. ADP pumps sodium out and potassium in, creating the sodium gradient that we need. Sodium gradient. What is this? Say again?
Sodium.
The sodium?
Calcium.
Ah, it could be, but it isn't. It's a secondary active transporter, so you got that right. And yes, one of the arrows is sodium flowing in. One of the arrows is sodium flowing in down its concentration gradient as established by the sodium potassium ATPase. But the other arrow is not calcium. Where are we going? What would the other arrow be?
Neurotransmitter.
This is a neurotransmitter, the dot, dot, dots. This is a sodium neurotransmitter co-transporter. So this, I've just defined the molecular mechanisms for reuptake of neurotransmitter. I think some of you had this on a test from CellFizz. Yes? This one here? Yes, this is called a sodium neurotransmitter co-transporter. It's secondary active transport of neurotransmitters because it is using the sodium gradient to drive the uptake of neurotransmitter. Ramiro?
Is that the main actor in the reuptake?
That is the main actor in reuptake. In reuptake from synapse into the cytosol. We haven't repackaged it yet, but we have retaken it up into the cytosol. We still have to repackage it into the vesicles. Okay? So we've gotten neurotransmitter back into the cytoplasm of the presynaptic terminal. Now we've got to get it into the vesicles. What is this symbol? Is it an ATPase?
Yes.
Yeah. So this is a an ATPase that's going to pump something into the vesicles. Does anybody remember what that something is? It's not neurotransmitter. It's not calcium.
H plus.
Protons. This is a proton or a hydrogen ion pump, proton, it acidifies the lumen of the vesicles. It makes the proton gradient, it builds a proton gradient. So the proton ATPase builds a proton gradient across this membrane. Okay, so what? What's this? Is it an ATPase? No, we don't see the little the arrow that is almost always coding for ATP hydrolysis. Is it a secondary active transporter?
Yeah.
Yeah. What do you suppose this arrow is? What is this flowing out?
Protons
down their concentration gradient. And what is this arrow going in exchange? This is an exchanger. What is this arrow?
Neurotransmitter,
a proton neurotransmitter exchanger, using the proton gradient in this case to pump neurotransmitter into the vesicles. And that's how neurotransmitter gets from synapse to cytoplasm to synaptic vesicles. Two steps of coupled transport, secondary active transport. One that depends on the sodium gradient and one that depends on the proton gradient. One that depends on the sodium gradient across the cell membrane and the other that depends on the proton gradient across the vesicular membrane. So now we have talked about the reuptake and packaging of neurotransmitters. Now, each synapse is going to release a specific neurotransmitter, and each specific neurotransmitter has its own secondary active transporters that are expressed at those synapses. So we can talk about the glutamate, the sodium excitatory neurotransmitter transporter here, and the proton glutamate exchanger here. But I don't think it's very important to talk about all the variations of this for each and every neurotransmitter. I'm going to start to introduce some of the most important neurotransmitters. But this is the overarching concept for all of them. Sodium-dependent uptake of neurotransmitter into the cytosol, and then proton exchange transport into the lumen of the vesicles, and then vesicle transport, and then vesicle fusion or release like that we have just talked about. Question?
Does one neuron release only one neurotransmitter, or one synapse?
One neuron releases one type of neurotransmitter, and the one is in quotes because sometimes they release two. But they are never an excitatory and an inhibitory neurotransmitter. There can often be release of a primary neurotransmitter and a secondary neuromodulator.
Thank you.
Yes?
For the reuptake of neurotransmitter, I thought there will be an endocytosis to repackage the transmitter.
So the process of recovering the membrane is endocytosis, but the process of recovering the neurotransmitter is transport. So when this vesicle, fuses, and let me just illustrate that concept. So this vesicle has fused and dumped its neurotransmitter into the vesicle, and then there is the process of clathrin-coating endocytosis that depends on Rab, we talked about this in CellPhys, that then recovers this patch of membrane into a clathrin-coated pit, and remakes, it's not happening here, it would probably happen out here, but it remakes the vesicle. But the vesicle is not loaded. The vesicle is just a vesicle, and it's not loaded until this happens. Yes?
So, if endocytosis is responsible for the reabsorption of the membrane, what prevents, like, for example, the hydrogen ATPase from acting in the membrane when it hasn't already been endocytosis?
Because the duration of time that this membrane is in this membrane is relatively short.
Okay.
Endocytosis is relatively rapid. And there might be mechanisms, I'm not sure, there might be mechanisms for control of the proton ATPase so that it's not functioning when this vesicle is fused. That there could be upper level control mechanisms that I'm not familiar with.
So
yes?
Does that mean that neurotransmitters are recycled?
Neurotransmitters are recycled. So the synthesis, so let's go back. So this is the recycling of neurotransmitter. The synthesis of neurotransmitter is happening here as well. So neurotransmitters are both synthesized and recycled. And let me go on to that, because we'll talk about the synthesis of some, but not all neurotransmitters. So, so there is a concept, so we're going to get to synthesis of neurotransmitter, but there is a concept that I would like to introduce, and that is the concept of modulation of synapses. Synapses are not really all or none things. They are modulated. So let's try to understand this cartoon. What is this thing? What is B? Synaptic terminal. What are these purple jobs? Mitochondria, because we need ATP all over the place. What are these decorated things here? Synaptic vesicles. And what are these little wedge, you know, triangle things? Neurotransmitter molecules, right? So this is the main synapse, right? This is a synapse that is releasing this neurotransmitter, and it's interacting with these postsynaptic receptors that we'll be talking about soon. This is called an axodendritic synapse. Because it's going from an axon to a dendrite. But throughout the nervous system, there's this other kind of synapse, a modulatory synapse, that is called a axo-axonic synapse. I don't really like the name because it's not synapsing on the axon, it's synapsing on the axon's synaptic terminal. So I would prefer it be called axotermonic or something synapse, but they didn't ask me. So the axon of another neuron, a modulatory neuron, is going to modulate the release of this neurotransmitter. How? In some cases, by altering calcium levels in this presynaptic terminal. So if this receptor to this neurotransmitter is coupled to GQ, what would happen to the calcium levels here when this receptor was activated? It would go up, because GQ would be, even though we don't see the endoplasmic reticulum, it's there, the GQ story would lead to an increase in calcium, and so the basal level of calcium due to activation of this receptor would go up. And then, so we would have calcium going up because of this receptor, And we would have calcium go up. If there was an action potential, calcium would go up because of the activation of voltage-gated calcium channels. Calcium would go up more in the presence of activity here. And so this synapse would release more neurotransmitter if this synapse is active. And so that would cause presynaptic facilitation. Is that clear? How this synapse facilitates the release of neurotransmitter at this synapse. Facilitation is just sort of amplification. What if this receptor was coupled to GI, which I'll tell you now, can be coupled. You know that it inhibits adenylyl cyclase, but some GI coupled receptors are also activate potassium channels. You did this in the problem set. A G protein activated potassium channel, GIRK. GIRK. A G protein activated potassium channel, GIRK. G for G protein, K for potassium, IR for the biophysical properties that it has called inward rectification. Don't have to go there. So if this receptor activates GIRK channels, what's going to happen to the voltage of this part of the cell? Hyperpolarize or depolarize?
Hyperpolarize.
More potassium channels will make active, more open potassium channels, just like you saw in the problem set, will make this part of the cell more negative. Is that going to facilitate or inhibit neurotransmitter release at this synapse? It'll inhibit it because it's making the membrane potential more negative, making it harder for voltage-gated calcium channels to open, making them open for a shorter duration, less calcium influx, less neurotransmitter release. So this synapse is performing presynaptic inhibition. Okay? So we have the axodendritic synapse and the modulatory axoaxonic synapse. And I'm going to ask you, probably in an exam setting, to put these concepts together. And you know, I'd give you information about what kind of receptor was expressed here, and what kind of neurotransmitter was expressed here, and what kind of neurotransmitter was expressed here. So if this neurotransmitter is a GABA-activated chloride channel, and this neurotransmitter is GABA, what is going to happen to this cell when this synapse is activated? Is it going to hyperpolarize or depolarize? Under normal conditions, this is not a neonatal developing neuron. It'll hyperpolarize. Remember from the problem set, influx of chloride tends to hyperpolarize, and that's why GABA is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. If this neurotransmitter activates a GIRK channel, is it going to increase or decrease the activity, the release of GABA? Decrease it. Will decreasing the release of GABA, what will this neuron do to the overall properties of this neuron? Make it more inhibited or less inhibited? Think about it. Less inhibited. Inhibition of inhibition is less inhibition. So these are the sorts of problems that I'll come back to. Okay, so here's some problems. You can think that the Moodle will have this. I think I already walked through this. Forgot that I had a slide up here that actually had the questions posed. But I didn't pose it in the setting of a nicotinic receptor. So you can work on that. That's homework. There's a question that you can do for homework. Here's a question that we did in class. So now we get to a part of the course that I don't love because it's just a lot of information. And I do want you to know the information. But it's kind of boring to teach it in this class. I mean, it's kind of boring to just teach it. But it shouldn't be boring for you to study it. That seems like a conflict. I want you to know, because we're speaking the language, you're now becoming more advanced neurophysiologists. I want you to know the language of some of the details of neurotransmitters. So I want you to know the language of acetylcholine and dopamine and norepinephrine and serotonin. Those are some, but not anywhere near all, of the key neurotransmitters. And I want you to know that dopamine is a catecholamine, and it's a tyrosine derivative. I want you to know that norepinephrine is a catecholamine. I want you to know that all catecholamines are monoamines, but not all monoamines are catecholamines. This is part of the language of being a neurophysiologist. I want you to know that serotonin is a monoamine, but not a catecholamine. I want you to understand the difference between ionotropic receptors and GPCRs, but I don't want you to memorize which neurotransmitters have which types of receptors. That you can look up. I want you to know what the difference between an ionotropic nicotinic acetylcholine receptor is and a GPCR acetylcholine receptor is. I want you to understand that difference, but I don't need you to know that acetylcholine has both and dopamine only has GPCR receptors. That's a detail that I don't need you to know. Okay, so you don't have to know everything on this slide, but you do have to know some. I do want you to know that dopamines, that the primary location in the brain of dopaminergic neurons are these two areas called the substantia nigra and the ventral tegmental area. V stands for ventral. I just ran out of space. Ventral. That's part of the language of understanding dopaminergic neurotransmission, which is going to become really important. I do want you to know that norepinephrine, the cell bodies of norepinephrine neurons, are primarily in this part of the brain called the locus coeruleus. We'll come back to this, I guess, on Tuesday. This is not on the quiz. Not on this quiz. There's another quiz, but it's not on this week. This is not on this weekend's quiz. Okay? But it's still, you do need to know it eventually. Okay? So this is neuroanatomy, in a sense, because you're learning what neurotransmitters are in what parts of the brain. I'm happy to entertain questions about what you need to know in terms of this language of neurotransmitter. We'll start on Tuesday by talking about some of these classic neurotransmitters. Remember, this information is anatomy and physiology, not on the quiz, and we'll pick this up on Tuesday. You do have a quiz based on with the key concepts on the sheet, that is due on Sunday. Okay, so have a good weekend, everybody.
Yes, sir.
Enjoy the